Generative phonology. Generative phonology is very important within the history of phonological studies of speech sound or within linguistics. Let me give you the brief history of phonology or phonological studies. Okay, there is a first stage of the history of phonology, which is called pre-generative phonology. Pre-generative phonology, that it was the stage before the, you know, the development of the generative phonology, right? There are basically three stages of the history of phonology. One is the pre-generative phonology era, okay? And then generative phonology, and then post-generative phonology. So since generative phonology is very important, so we can just discuss that what are those stages regarding generative phonology. Okay, stage one, pre-generative era, which was basically the initial era, the initial time of 20th century. Okay, it was early 20th century, and if you remember, the International Phonetic Association was already established in 1897, right? So people, experts especially, they had started working on phonology scientifically. But in the beginning of 20th century, the nature of the role of science was, discussed, and it was changed, right? That was study of the naturalism by Darwin, all right? So at the early 20th century, and linguistic was accepted as a scientific field, right? And the scientific traditions were started. And in the second decade of 20th century, if you remember the Swiss linguist, Ferdinand de Saussure, he had also started working on structuralism. He gave the idea of structuralism, right? So that is the pre-generative era, right? When phonology was discussed, and it was based on classifications, right? Sounds were classified. So that was the first stage. And then there was generative phonology era, okay? When Chomsky and Hall, when they gave the idea of generative phonology on the basis of the SPE, sound patterns in English, right? So that was the second stage within the history of phonology. And then there is the third stage, which is post-generative phonology. Post-generative phonology is basically this time, like the modern era, when phonology was influenced by generative phonology, and when other linguists, they also started contributing towards the generative phonology. All right, Chomsky and Hall, they initiated the idea of generative phonology. And generative phonology was basically the extension of the Chomskyan idea of transformational generative grammar, TGG, right? According to this idea, the native speaker's competence was the basic requirement for creating or the production of sounds. And also, if we just take the mentalism, the idea of mentalism within grammar, then that competence was a basic requirement in order to come up with well-formed sentences and well-formed sounds by the native speakers. So extending that idea to phonology, Chomsky and Hall, they developed the idea of generative phonology, right? And they said that establish rules and then produce well-formed sentences. Rules are limited and its application is unlimited, right? Finite rules and infinite application. So that was the idea which was basically applied within generative phonology. And then there was a major shift that, like before that, it was said that phoneme is the basic unit within phonology. But Chomsky and Hall, they developed that not the phoneme, but feature of phoneme, that's the basic requirement for further analysis. Like, for example, if I just pronounce one stop, P is one phoneme, right? But they said that, no, there are features applied on P. P is basically a unit which is based on various features. Like P is, it is a stop, right? So it's the manner of its articulation, that's the feature. Then it is voiceless. P is voiceless. So there is a feature of voicelessness also. And then it may be aspirated in some context. So the feature of aspiration may also be investigated and studied, right? And then it is bilabial. P is bilabial. So it's again, the bilabial feature is there on this sound. So they just you know said that features are important and we should investigate features, right? And then the lexical representation with the generative phonology is also important. Like, for example, there are words in English which end with ik sound, like elastic or electric, right? But when they are converted from adjectives into nouns, then we just add siti. The k sound is further shifted to ct, right? Like electricity or elasticity, right? So they take examples from these sounds, and then they just said that generalization can be made on the basis of certain forms in a language, right? And then they developed a grammar on the basis of the sound patterns of English, right? So this idea, like the sounds can be generated, and they have got natural, you know, affiliations and natural features, and sounds can be grouped into various sounds, which are based on natural classes, right? So that was the idea which was further developed. And then they said that there are rules, underlying representation, underlying rules, and then the surface rules, and rules to derive the surface representation. So generative phonology was basically based on various rules. Like, some examples of rules are there, that assimilation take place, like some sounds, they are assimilating into others, and then naturalization, deletion, and appendices. Assimilation, like one example of assimilation is green bus, two different words, but now becomes m, green bus, in a phrase like green bus, okay? So that's assimilation. And then deletion, like some speakers, the speakers of other languages, when they acquire English, then they delete some of the consonants in order to just, you know, pronounce them, because the their languages, if they don't have clusters in their native languages, then they may not be able to pronounce those clusters together. So that's an example of deletion. And then appendices, when some sounds are put into words and they are added to that, right? So that's appendices. And such were the rules of phonological, rules within generative phonology. And they are further applied. And theories were developed further on the basis of generative phonology. Let me give you the examples of theories which stemmed out of generative phonology. One is the autosegmental phonology. When the studies were carried out on the basis of autosegments, like the tonal study of Igbo language, that was the major language which was carried out, and then metrical phonology, when meters of the phonology were studied, when within phonology, meters were given the basic role, like how the cataphoric and anaphoric movement, and that metrical phonology was very important in order to describe the stress patterns of languages, right? And then lexical phonology, that was also an outcome of generative phonology, and optimality theory, which is one of the most popular theories today. It's like the framework of, interactions among constraints. Constraints are basically those limitations within languages which are hierarchically distributed within specific languages. So that's the idea of grammar. And optimality theory was developed in 1992 by Polanski and Prince and Polanski. And they applied it on generatively on the basis of generative rules. And it's now very popularly applied within phonology and also outside phonology. It is now also applied within morphology and syntax. So generative phonology, it played the role of, an umbrella theory. And many theories in the post-generative era, they were stemmed out of this generative phonology.